I think it's a very interesting and challenging experience for an audience. And I can honestly say I don't believe anyone has ever seen a movie like this. I really genuinely, that is the one thing that people take out of the theater. They say, I have never seen a movie like this, and I've never had an experience like this. It's a very painfully emotional film, and I think that's the biggest surprise. Is that a movie can start out with such a high concept, and by midway through the film, you are so invested in the characters and so moved by them that you see your own small details and tapestries of your life with your family through them, and you completely forget that, you know, he's got a puppet on his hand.
Open the film.
Well, we find Walter Black floating through his life when we come to meet him first. He is always alone. He's mostly sleeping. He's depressed. Life means nothing to him. He can barely speak. And he recognizes that he used to be a man that had everything. He had a family he loved, a wife he loved, a job that was passed down to him, but a lucrative job. And all of those things have lost their meaning. A miraculous thing occurs, and he, in some ways, in order to continue to live, in order to say, I want to live, he has to separate himself into another character that's this puppet that finds himself on his hand. It's a beautiful script that has a lot of wit to it, and it's incredibly intricately well written. And the characters are witty, and they're all of them. Very intelligent and very solitary. So it will always have its whimsy, but I really am here for one reason only, and that is to say, is it true or is it not true? And when you're telling the tale of somebody who can see no other way of living, no other avenue in life but to kill himself, you have to take that very seriously. And we take that very seriously in the movie. You know, the movie is about somebody who desperately, desperately has to figure out a way to live again, and this is the only thing that he comes up with. Yeah, the beaver is in some ways fighting for supremacy. You know, he's fighting to win, and he wants, you know, as a coping mechanism, he wants to survive. And you know, his alter ego, Walter, or the beaver is Walter's alter ego, you know. Walter is scared that if he loses the beaver, he'll return to that horrible person that he was, that he can't face again. So the beaver, in some ways, subsumes his personality and really shunts aside anyone that will get away, that will take away from that very intimate relationship that he has with Walter. In some ways, it's the only really intimate relationship that Walter's had in many, many, many years. You know, he's his best friend. He's the one who loves him. And as the beaver tries to convince him, the only one who really loves him. And so Walter, in some ways, has to make a choice. The beaver asks him to make a choice between the beaver and his family. Yeah, I think that there are many, many, many genuine examples in our culture over and over and over again where people do things, will don a different personality, will split themselves in order to cope with an unsurvivable situation. Well, Walter Black and the Beaver had to be somebody who could fully understand and communicate comedy and tragedy at the same time. You know, I've been friends with Mel for over 15 years. He's such a talented actor. I mean, I feel amazingly blessed to have somebody like that who really took on the character, brought so much to it, and no muss, no fuss. I mean, he came in and you know, it was two takes, and he left. You know, that's who Mel is. I think probably the most light of foot in some ways actor I've ever worked with. Well, Mel got really into the puppeteering, and I kept saying, like, oh, don't worry about the puppeteering. You know, the guy doesn't know how to do it. He doesn't have to be perfect. But in the end, Mel was really right, because as time went on and Mel got better and better at lip syncing, in some ways that were his vocalizing lip syncs with the, it really makes a big difference, because you do start forgetting. You start forgetting that the beaver is not a real person. It was a kind of this amazing challenge for Mel. You know, first of all, it was his left hand, which is really hard for anybody who's right-handed to continually do this. There's all these very difficult things you have to do in puppeteering. You only move your thumb, not this. So you move your thumb to move the mouth. Getting the beaver to look at the camera, so that there were moments where he really wanted the eyes to connect with the camera, but sometimes he'd be in a weird position, so it would have to be like this. He'd get these awful, awful cramps. I'm sure he's going to have severe damage for the rest of his life. It's terrible. He could only go through, you know, a quarter of a page of dialogue without going like, oh, that completely cramping up. But I think it gave him something to take his mind off the performance, which in some ways just completely freed him up. Anton's just such an amazing young actor, and I think that he brings, you know, two things are working at the same time. One is incredible depth, and the other is a real wit and lightness. And he has both things at the same time, which is kind of hard to find with young actors. I've experienced this problem with casting over and over again. A lot of young guys, 19, 20 years old, want to, you know, have lots of three-day stubble and a trench coat and mumble and, you know, go like this with their head and, you know, have anxiety. It's much easier for a young person in some ways to think of themselves as dark, as it is much harder for them to see the vulnerability, to want to really put forth the vulnerabilities and the unsureness and the lack of confidence and some of the, just the kind of sprightliness of being a young person. I find that teenage boys just want to cover that right up. Yeah, you know, conceptualizing the puppet was such a big thing on everyone's mind. They were like, what's the puppet going to look like? What's the puppet going to look like? So we went through all sorts of different possibilities of avenues, you know. Is the puppet like a full-on CGI, not CGI, but like a major construction, you know? Is it abstract? Is it just like a sock with two eyes on it? Is it something that resembles a beaver in the woods, you know, that would have one of those tails and that has fur and stuff? And is it something that, you know, will you do like a weird CGI thing where the eyes move around and look at you and stuff? And we really realized that in some ways he starts out as a prop, you know. He's just a prop. He's just something he finds in a dumpster. And the quality that personification quality that the puppet has in the beginning is really by accident. It's really just you investing that in, you projecting that into it. In some ways, it's, you know, it's something that's been cast aside, that some child played with 40 years ago, and that carries with it the childhoodness, that almost the trauma of childhood, you know. So it's not like, it's not any, it was, we went through all of these different paths to try and come up with something that in some ways is really just something that comes out of his gut, you know. It's something that comes out of his stomach, not something that comes out of a textbook puppet thing. of course, you know, I directed the movie, and I love his performance. I feel like it's one of the deepest performances that Mel's ever given, and the most true to who he is in some strange way. And I think the most that you will empathize with the most. Yes, a man grappling with a spiritual crisis, and, you know, it's stuff that he and I have been talking about for many, many years. And there's nobody who's, you know, a ruminator, right? Which is somebody who writes or paints or acts or who does a creative thing where you have to keep going over it, over it, and over it, and over it, that isn't caught up in a spiritual crisis in some ways, because you love going through pain and trying to figure it out. But I don't know, I think that's lucky, because I think that's an incredibly lucky skill to have the ability to look demons in the face and say, you know, I'm going to do whatever it takes to kick you in the ass.